partnering with us and developing a supply chain that brings Australian manganese into Japan and uses our process to convert it to high-purity manganese sulphate, they get all the benefits of that, and they also get IRA compliance, so they can continue to supply into markets that they've traditionally done. So important for us, important for them, I think.
Hello and welcome back to the Proactive Studio. I'm Tylah Tully and joining me today is Element 25 Managing Director Justin Brown to talk us through the partnership it's entered with Nissan Chemical Corporation. Justin, thanks for joining us.
Hi Tylah, nice to be with you.
So this is great news for Element 25. Talk me through this partnership and where Nissan fit into your broader strategy to establish a global network of HPMSM facilities.
Yeah, as your listeners and our investors would be aware, we have a effectively hub and spoke model around our long-term plans for HPMSM refining capacity around the globe. So in other words, what we intend to do is take the high-quality manganese ore from Butcherbird and export it through the Port Hedland facilities to an array of refineries in key target markets, and obviously Japan's one of those. So we've been working with our Japanese partners for some years to develop the relationships which have resulted in this announcement, and it's a really important step in developing that pipeline of projects. So in other words, the Louisiana project is still our number one focus for current short-term refinery capacity, but in the longer term we'd like to expand that capacity to other markets including Japan and ultimately Europe as well.
Yeah, you've mentioned Japan. What are the potential benefits of utilising Nissan's existing Tokyo Bay site for the new facility proposed in Japan?
Yeah, the Tokyo Bay site is really interesting because it has established sulfuric acid production. It also, through Nissan Chemical's other subsidiaries, we've got access to other key reagents that are required for the refining process that we use to convert the Butcherbird ore into high-purity manganese sulfate for battery applications. It also is an established industrial site, so it has a lot of the things that you would normally expect for an industrial development, like electricity, water, and the like, as well as bulk handling capability so that we can bring the manganese ore in and then process it, with all the synergies that go with establishing or further developing an existing site rather than trying to do a greenfield site. So it should mean savings in capital cost in certain areas, and it should also mean shortening of timelines with respect to permits and other aspects that would go with a more greenfields type site.
And how does Japan's strategic interest in manganese, particularly for its electric vehicle industry, influence this partnership?
So Japan's been a key player in the battery industry for a long time. Your listeners would know that names like Panasonic are not new to the battery sort of conversation. So they have a lot of technical capability, a lot of expertise and well-established industrial capacity to produce batteries. And of course, to do that, they need the raw materials like manganese to build those batteries. They are affected, like everybody, by the monopoly that China holds over a lot of these key raw material supply chains. And they are very keen, I think, to produce IRA-compliant material for the US markets in particular so they can maintain market share in that space. So by partnering with us and developing a supply chain that brings Australian manganese into Japan and uses our process to convert it to high-purity manganese sulfate, they get all the benefits of that, and they also get IRA compliance, so they can continue to supply into markets that they've traditionally done. So important for us, important for them, I think.
And moving forward, what are the key milestones that are expected in the feasibility study between the two companies?
Yeah, so the MOU maps out a number of steps, and they are steps that wouldn't be a surprise to anybody. They're things like a scoping study, things like an engineering evaluation of the site, things like a economic assessment of the cost of production, which would ultimately result in a full feasibility study, which will define in some detail the scenarios that might be possible around developing that site to produce high-purity manganese sulfate. And the expectation is that will result in a definitive feasibility study, which will form the basis of financing discussions and then a final investment decision as outlined in the announcement. So a number of sort of milestones, but nothing that wouldn't be normal for a project of this type.
So what are the next steps?
Yeah, so next steps, we're building our communications and things with Nissan, building out the systems. We're identifying partners around the EPCM side of the project. We're obviously starting the work on the ground to do the assessment that will lead to the scoping study results. And then ultimately, we'll bring those results to market as they come to hand. And you'll see that project build in size and speed as we move towards a final investment decision over the next couple of years.
Justin, very exciting times for the company. We look forward to hearing all about it as it progresses. Thanks for your time today.
Thanks, Tana. Really appreciate it. Bye for now.